Thank you very much for joining. My name is Denis Makarov. I am from Helmholtz-Zentrum Dresden-Rossendorf, which is in Dresden in Germany. I'm happy to present our activities on nanomagnetism and spintronics of chromia magnetoelectric antiferromagnets. As you can see, we benefit from the broad network of collaborators who contribute to the sample fabrication, sample characterization, and also to the theoretical analysis of the effects, which I will present in this talk. On the technological side, our motivation comes from magnetic random access memory. One of the possible classifications of families of MRAM is shown here. It depends on from which material you read out the information and how you write the information. For example, if you use ferromagnets to read out the information from and you use charge current to write the information, you will be in the realm of conventional magnetic random access memory, which is commercially available product. There is an antiferromagnetic counterpart of MRAM where you use charge current to write information in, for example, metallic antiferromagnet and read out the information from metallic antiferromagnet. Our work is inspired by the activities of the group of Christian Binek on the realization of magnetoelectric random access memory, where the magnetoelectric insulating antiferromagnet chromium oxide is interfaced with ferromagnet and the magnetic state of the ferromagnet can be manipulated by the electric field which is applied across the antiferromagnetic insulating material. In our work, we removed the ferromagnet from the stack and ended up with antiferromagnetic magnetoelectric random access memory, where the memory cell contains only chromium oxide as a magnetoelectric insulator, which is interfaced with platinum readout electrode to access the magnetic state of the antiferromagnet. As many other groups in the community, we work with chromium oxide, which is the only uniaxial antiferromagnet which has magnetoelectric effect at room temperature. Already from 60s, it is known that this magnetoelectric effect is a linear magnetoelectric effect. It means that one can modify the magnetic state or the antiferromagnetic state of the material by the combined action of electric and magnetic fields. The very strong advantage of uniaxial antiferromagnet with an out-of-plane easy axis is the possibility to read out the magnetic state of the antiferromagnet unambiguously using conventional magnetotransport techniques. In this case, one has to monitor the field invariant transversal resistance after the sample was exposed to a specific cooling field or combined magnetoelectric cooling field. What you can see on this slide is a linear magnetoelectric effect in the thin film of chromium oxide, which is encoded in a Hall resistance transversal resistance, which is measured on this material upon cooling the sample through the Néel temperature in magnetic and electric field. Such magnetoelectric cooling allows you to set up the antiferromagnetic state, and this state now can be manipulated, for example, by electric voltage at constant temperature, so isothermally, without any need to modify the magnetic field, which contributes to the application potential of this memory concept. What you can see on the left-hand side that for the specific conditions, also at room temperature, you can open the magnetoelectric hysteresis loop, you can get two remnant states, which allows you to record information in this thin film. The MRAM operation is demonstrated in this slide, where you can use electric field pulses to write information into the chromium oxide, you can store the information in the antiferromagnetic order parameter, and read out information using the platinum electrode. And you can repeat this for many times, mimicking the operation of conventional MRAM. To enable such kind of measurements, we rely on a zero offset Hall preset of the tensorometer device, which allows us to reject any parasitic leakage of longitudinal resistances in the transversal resistance channel, meaning that we will have the pure transversal resistance, which is the quantity related to the antiferromagnetic order parameter of chromium oxide thin film. In order to understand the physics of the measured signal, we collaborate with a group of Sebastian Gernenwein at the University of Konstanz. As you can see, we pattern our sample in Hall bar geometries, which allows us to measure not only the transversal resistance, but also magnetoresistance when the sample is exposed to magnetic fields which are rotated in three orthogonal planes as is schematically shown here. By analyzing the angular dependence of magnetoresistance, we can identify the clear fingerprints of the spin hole magnetoresistance. Therefore, our current understanding is that the readout signal which we measure in the transversal and longitudinal channel below and above the Néel temperature of chromium oxide is related to the transversal and longitudinal spin hole magnetoresistance in the platinum, which is interfaced with chromium oxide magnetoelectric insulator. Similar to the ferromagnet, the evolution of this electrical readout can be understood only if you have access to the magnetic domain pattern of the material. In the case of antiferromagnet, you need to image the antiferromagnetic domains, which puts very strong requirements to the sensitivity of the imaging technique. As you can see, in this TEM image, our thin film consists of grains with a size of in a range of less than 50 nanometers. And now the question is how the antiferromagnetic domain walls interact with the grain boundaries, what is the evolution of antiferromagnetic domain pattern with temperature, with magnetic fields. To answer these questions, we established a very fruitful collaboration with a group of Patrick Maletinsky at the University of Basel. They are experts in scanning nitrogen vacancy magnetometry or NV microscopy, which they successfully applied to study antiferromagnetic materials. In the essence, the technique allows you to measure the magnetic stray field and magnetic stray field distributions over the surface of the sample. The blue and red contrast is a real space imaging of antiferromagnetic domain. What you can see is that domains are relatively large, a couple of hundreds of nanometers, which are substantially larger than the individual grain size, meaning that the individual chromium oxide antiferromagnetic grains are exchange coupled to some extent to allow observing such kind of magnetic domain pattern. The strong advantage of NV microscopy is that it provides you possibility to access not only the quantitative stray field distribution over the sample, but also provides access to the magnetization of the sample. Now you can monitor the change of the contrast as a function of temperature. In this case, you can get even access to the transition temperature from antiferromagnetic to paramagnetic state by determining when the contrast from the antiferromagnetic domain pattern disappears. In our case, this temperature is about 302 Kelvin, which is a couple of Kelvin smaller than the high-quality single crystalline materials of chromium oxide. In order to understand what is the impact of the presence of defects like grain boundaries on the pinion of magnetic domain walls, we went back to the analysis of the very well-defined system. It's a single crystalline chromia with a C-axis and the Z-axis pointing out of plane. The quality of this material is very good, meaning that antiferromagnetic domain walls were not stable in the samples. In order to stabilize the domain wall, we patterned the array of MESA structures, as it's shown here schematically, on the surface of the sample and performed magnetoelectric cooling of the material through the Néel temperature to impose the presence of magnetic domain wall, which is now pinned on one of these MESA structures. As you can see, the domain wall in the interior of the sample is actually straight line, and only at the location of the MESA, it acquires a very interesting modification of the profile. You can obviously see and recognize such kind of a S-shaped profile at the location of MESA. We performed theoretical analysis of this S-shaped curve and came to the conclusion that this is a pure geometrical effect, and the tilt of the domain wall at the edge of the MESA is determined by the thickness to width ratio of the MESA structure. In this case, the tilt of the domain wall at the MESA can be controlled by the geometrical parameters of the material. Another important feature comes from the analysis of the domain wall profile in the interior of the film. As you can see from the right-hand side image, the domain wall in the sample is actually flat. It's like a plane which is deformed only when the domain wall approaches the surface of the sample. If you have such a possibility to deform only the domain wall at the surface of the sample, then you have an interesting possibility to manipulate the domain wall and use it for some recording application. Please pay attention to this left-hand side image. The domain wall in the bulk is shown with a dashed line. It's an equilibrium position of the domain wall. Now you can use the laser light from the NV microscope to drag the domain wall from this equilibrium position and simply make it pin at the edge of the MESA. There are two important characteristics which are recognizable in this image. First of all, the main wall can be elongated substantially. It's displaced several micrometers, as you can see on this image. Another aspect is that the domain wall follows very precisely the very sharp edge of the MESA. In this case, what you can tell about the mechanics of magnetic domain wall in chromium oxide, that it resembles something which is similar from the elastic ribbons. That would be an appropriate model how you can understand the behavior of the magnetic domain walls in this material. What is interesting is that you can use the laser beam in order to manipulate the position of the domain wall, achieving the stable pinion on one edge of the MESA or on another edge of the MESA, which enables interesting possibility to even consider such kind of elastic domain wall in a material as a possibility to write information by following how the domain wall follows the MESA structures which are patterned on the surface of the chromium oxide single crystalline material. The interaction of non-collinear textures with boundaries and with surfaces in antiferromagnets is actually very poorly understood even for three-dimensional antiferromagnets. In this case, Alexander Pilipovsky made an effort to describe the impact of boundaries on chiral G-type antiferromagnets. In this case, the antiferromagnet has exchange anisotropy and Dzelushinsky-Maria interaction in the material. Now, what is happening if you have the ground state? The ground state for the case when DMI strength is subcritical is a collinear antiferromagnet in the interior of the material. As soon as the Neel vector is approaching the boundary, it acquires a tilt, and this tilt can be substantial. It depends on the strength of Dzelushinsky-Maria interaction and can reach 10 or 20 degrees even for the realistic strength of the Dzelushinsky-Maria interaction constant. It's a sizable effect which should be observable in experiments. The qualitatively similar picture can be obtained also for non-collinear textures, where antiferromagnetic domain wall, for example, also gets modified upon approaching to this edge of the sample. It gets broader, the plane of the domain wall gets also modified, it acquires a tilt, it also bend, and the direction of this bend is determined by the sign of the Dzelushinsky-Maria interaction. Qualitatively similar picture is observed also for antiferromagnetic skirmions. For example, in this case, you have a Bloch-type skirmion stabilized in an antiferromagnetic slab. Upon approaching to the surfaces, the skirmion string becomes broader, and also the phase of the skirmion changing. It means that instead of Bloch skirmion, like in the interior, you will have a mixed Niel-Bloch skirmion at the surfaces. What is important to mention that the main wall and the skirmion has a modification over several exchange lenses on each side. Therefore, if you want to work with the bulk-like properties of skirmion or the main wall, we have to make sure that the sample thickness and the sample width are sufficiently large, being at least in a range of 15 to 20 exchange lenses to enable the bulk properties of these textures. This is, of course, important for the design of antiferromagnetic racetracks, which are based on antiferromagnetic domains and antiferromagnetic skirmions as information carriers. At this point, I'm at the very end of my talk. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm very happy to any questions which you might have. Thank you very much.